right. I'm gonna pause that right there. Hello, everybody. Sam here in the UK on the South Coast. Nice to be back with the Licklibrary live streams. Hope you're all doing well. I'm just going to check through our comment section. I can see lots of people saying hello. Hello, David, Jeremy, Claude, Victor. Nice to see you. Let's have a look at Thomas, Kate, Timothy, Keith Moff, Tony, Thomas. Oh, so lovely. Love some familiar names and some names that fantastic. Ah, oh, lovely to see you all from around the world. Again, it always perplexes me that I'd be sat in my small flat here in the UK and we can connect together across the world. It's amazing. East Sussex. Lots of people from Sussex. Sussex is a cool place. Okay, so today I've been given the task of discussing practice to performance. So today's session is going to be maybe a little bit more talky. I'm going to try and play as much as possible, but this is more about the subject of learning a piece of music to be able to perform it at a professional level, whatever that might mean, professional level or high level, the best level that you can do. So I want to talk about some things that might be useful. Now, I am here with a few kind of challenges because YouTube has a funny copyright system, so I can't actually demonstrate how I'd learn a particular track. And I'm at the moment, you know, one of my jobs is playing in lots of different bands, and sometimes I'll get a call and they'll say, there's a gig this weekend, can you come along, here's the set list. And often the set list is, you know, 20 to 40 songs, and sometimes I'm lucky and the songs I've played in the past, and I'm not very good with memory, but you know, they'll come back. But often I had to learn a lot of stuff, and especially here at Licklibrary, you know, I do a lot of courses, I learn a lot of albums and things. So I'm slowly finding a process which kind of works for me, but I never like to kind of put my name to anything like that, because it can be different depending on the song, depending on the situation that you're playing in, and all that good stuff. So David Tompkins, how to fit sweet picking into pop songs, just do it. And just don't apologize. That's my advice on that one. I don't know if you want to, it depends on the gig. So yeah, I don't know if anybody here is a avid learner of songs. If you are in a cover band, or maybe you enjoy learning your favorite artist's songs, let us know in the comments. So if you're working on any particular songs or set lists, and as we go through, you know, share your experience, you know, in learning songs, because it'd be good to kind of break these points down. So that, you know, this is, like I said, practice to performance. So we're going to start with section number one, and that is going to be listening. Now, it is so obvious that if you're going to learn a song, you've got to listen to it. But historically, I've seen lots of students, and including myself, I consider myself a student, you forget to listen to the song. And if you're going to learn something, you need to have some kind of auditory picture of it in your mind. And to do that, you need to listen. And there's two types of listening, I would say. There's active listening and passive listening. Passive listening is what happens when you're just existing. You know, you're always hearing, always seeing, always smelling, always touching and tasting. That is who we really are. We are this kind of our amalgamation of senses coming together at seamlessly a point. But you know, the sound comes in and you can hear things, and some stuff goes in subconsciously, like those songs on the radio that you end up hearing for days on end. That can go in, that's good. But at the same time, there's active listening, especially about songs that you may want to learn. So let's say you get given, you want to learn a song, or you get given a set of songs, it's important to listen. And depending on what you're doing, I would like to say that it's probably imperative that you listen to a song at least 3 or 4 times before even picking up the guitar. Put the guitar down and listen to the song, first of all, just as a global picture, like what's the song sound like, you know, go through it. And then listening to the song's structure. So listening to how, you know, you might have a verse, a chorus, pre-chorus, is there a solo? Does it sound like sections repeat? Does it sound like it's all in the same key, or does it seem to change some places? Are there any moments where it goes a bit weird and you can't quite follow it? you know, and to listen back to it again and try and follow it. This is before we even think about playing it on guitar. So really getting it into your mind. Now, sometimes that's not always possible. You know, if I've got this set list I've got to learn of, I think this one's 20 songs actually, so it's not too bad. But I'm probably in the midst of all the other work I'm doing, I'm going to have to sort of listen to them once and then start learning them. And this brings us up to the next section of what we need to be doing. So making sure you're familiar with... I'm seeing some comments here saying my audio is low. I don't know if there's two people who have said that so far. I'm going to see if there's anything I can do about that. Try that, see if that makes any difference. Okay. So if you're, you know, you've got the song, you're listening to it, you're learning it, that's cool. And then the next thing is to actually then break it down. You can start to save time as you do that. The more you learn songs, the quicker your process becomes. And I think it is very much a process. Got some great tunes, by the way, people are learning. Cool. So first of all, you know, you've broken the structure down. You might say you've got sections A, B, and C in our metaphorical song. And then the next thing to do is then learn each section. Now, you can do this with tab. You can do this with lessons. Totally fine. All good. My encouragement is to do as much of it by ear as possible, because again, that's helping your ear training and your theory. And theory becomes quite useful when learning songs, because it gives you a kind of skeleton framework of commonly used patterns and things, which you can actually quickly kind of log certain parts of the song onto. You know, if you know what key it's in, if it's in the key of A minor, then you know what chords are in A minor. And you'll see that as a pattern on the fretboard, and you'll kind of memorize it that way, hopefully, as well as, you know, the particular voicings and rhythms and ways of playing in the song. So actually getting the structure down, and then breaking it into smaller parts. You know, if you have some sections, let's have a look. If we had a song which had... maybe that's the verse. So doing that sort of thing might be very helpful. You know, seeing, okay, this is A minor. That's the 6 chord. This is the 1 chord. This is the 4 chord. Now, if I know what they are and I've got fretboard knowledge, it becomes easier. And this is actually to do with playing confidence as well, if you're going to be performing this. If you know what you're playing and you make a mistake in a live performance, if you understand, if you've learned the song and you've kind of analysed it, you'll hopefully be able to... you know, kind of save yourself in those mistakes and those moments where you think, oh no, that's gone wrong. If you know your next chord is F and you can find the nearest F, then you're probably going to be in a better position than if you're just kind of, you've kind of memorized it from A to Z in tab numbers and stuff like that. It kind of, it really puts you at a disadvantage that way. So theory is helpful. And then the next thing is to play along with the track, and in sections as well. For Licklibrary, a lot of the performances, I remember doing a David Lee Roth Eatem and Smile course, and I did Ladies Night in Buffalo and Shy Boy and Yankee Rose. I did some performances of those tracks. And to practice that, you know, you break it into sections. You play along to the track. If you can slow it down, I use a software called Transcribe, which you just load the MP3 in and you can see your file on. It's only like, I think it's like $40, but it's probably the best $40 I've ever spent. I'm not sponsored by them, but it's just such a useful software. Transcribe by Seventh String Software. And you just load it in. You can mark your sections on it, and then you can loop them, slow them down, change the pitch. But if you can loop it somehow and just keep on playing along, you're then practicing the rhythm along with the track. You've got the visual element, you've got the auditory element going on. So that's really important. And then the next thing is to work on the transitions between sections, making sure that you are able to think ahead to the next section and play through more of the track. And then the other subject comes with tricky parts. And tricky parts are, you know, tricky. Especially, I saw somebody said they were learning Tornado of Souls. That's a hell of a track. And that's, you know, there's a crazy solo and the riffs are quite intense. But going back to, we're still on a breaking it down element of learning the song. So coming back to really focusing on, you know, okay, which section's the easiest one, which one's the hardest ones, and then delegating your time properly. I like to time myself. I do daily thing. If I'm working on a particularly tricky song, rather than spending hours on the tricky section, I'll give myself 20 minutes on a particular measure and then leave it for the day and come back to it the next day. And but around that, I might delegate the rest of that time, maybe 10 minutes to doing the rest of the song, going through the sections, just making sure they're there, and then performing it. This is if I'm working on something quite virtuosic, you know, like Pornograffiti, for example, or Extreme, or some one of my a metal track that I work on in my band. If I'm working on one of my own tunes for performance, I'll kind of work those small tricky sections out, go through them, make sure they're confident. Now, this is where it becomes kind of helpful to understand how we memorize and learn. And how we practice is actually how we end up performing, which is obviously when we come to sort of those roadblocks when we're trying to play through a song all the way, it's often because we've not smoothed out a transition, or we've not thought about something, or not listened deep enough. So there are three levels to memorizing things. There is the listening, being able to hear and recognize and hear when you're playing that part right or wrong. There is sight, and sight comes down to actually, especially on the guitar, it's a very visual instrument, actually seeing the patterns and systems that you'll be moving through in a riff. You know, a good, I'm going to do a copyright version, copyright free version, hopefully, of this riff. Let's say that's my riff, a tribute to Crazy Train. I'm aware that that's in F sharp minor. I've got this particular framework I'm working with, you know, these frets. You know, kind of keeping that in mind. Almost played it then. Oh dear. Hopefully we're okay. Hopefully the YouTube gods don't punish us. So, you know, seeing it, so hearing it, seeing it, and the next, the most important thing. I don't think this gets talked about enough. But how it feels to play. If you're practicing it and you're holding your breath and your head's over the guitar like this, if I go to the guitar cam, it's literally like that, you know, then you're probably there's probably some tension and anxiety right there, and you want to practice in the way that you want to play it, and hopefully you want to play it as effortlessly as possible, and you want it to feel good, because I guarantee most, even if the most of the licks that you hear your favorite players playing, they are probably quite natural things for them to play, generally, probably, you know, with the exception of a few moments. But most of those ideas are some things that fall under the fingers, and they have in their own vocabulary of musicianship. I hope this is making sense so far. And you know, getting the actual sensation of how it feels. And this actually goes into the tonal production as well. Like, is the tone right for the song? Are you using the right sound for the song? You know, it's no use playing Tornado of Souls with a clean tone because you're not going to get the same effects. The harmonics aren't going to come out in the right way. The bends aren't going to sustain in the right way. So, using the right tone. And I just to give a more practical playing example, maybe more of an exercise-based example. When you're playing your scales or arpeggios. How does it feel under your fingers? Are you feeling like that's a fight? Does how it feel kind of equate to how it should sound? And I think that's, even though that sounds very new age and special, I think we all know what it feels like to fret notes and pick notes, and we know that feeling of it when it feels connected and solid versus kind of running away from you and like you're trying to play a literal steel fence of strings rather than, you know, a nice, you know, fretboard that's kind of going with what you're playing. And of course, the practice methods you use are going to be helpful, you know, slowing it down, playing in time of the track. I think when if you can slow the track down and play along with it, that's probably better than just playing free time, because then you're picking up the feel of the player or the riff that's going on as well, and that inevitably gets you into the feel. And just constantly checking in with your posture. You know, I'm practicing keeping my head, you know, up and back, so I'm not kind of doing this, and that helps with breathing, keeping the shoulders relaxed, keeping the fingers nice and light on the fretboard. I'm just seeing how relaxed I can approach the guitar. You know, there's no reason why I need to be all hunched up. So kind of keeping that nice and light. You know, and then letting things happen. If a mistake happens, it's okay. It's not the end of the world. I don't know what that wasn't even a song. That was just a load of noodling. But hopefully you get the idea. You know, keeping it light, keeping your touch light. So, and this is actually to practice the feeling of effortless. Now, these three things come together. Hearing, understanding how it sounds, seeing, understanding how it looks. And I would say part of seeing and hearing is also theoretical as well. So understanding, okay, this is a C chord, I'm playing a D minor 7, this is a scale pattern, I'm in this position. All these little pointers help us add another layer to the memorization of a riff or a song. And then that should hopefully get it into your muscle memory and ear memory so that when you hear, you can play. And here's the professional bit. I notice myself and on YouTube, Instagram covers, and I teach at a college and we have to, you know, watch performances of students. And there's a general difference between when you've learnt by numbers and just got the parts, which I would call knowledge. You know, you've just sort of memorized it. You know, you can sort of visualize it on a fretboard and you know it in sequence, you know, that sort of thing. And you're thinking about everything you're doing versus actually playing the song, which is, I'd say, is more wisdom element where you're able to actually listen, not only in a one point. So one pointed awareness is when you're thinking about, okay, it's this thing moving to this thing on the fretboard, then it's that. But then your open awareness, where you're actually able to take in the drummer, the bassist, the vocalist, how the song sounds, almost as if you're listening to your own playing as, well, you're just listening. You're almost just listening to it as if it was pre-recorded already. Then you can get into the time feel and the tonal production and the performance. If you're playing it live, you can look into the audience, you can move a bit, you can gel with the musicians, and then the song starts to actually become alive. And that's the difference, I would say, between kind of quote-unquote amateur playing, which I don't think even professionals can play like amateurs, and I'm evidence of that, versus professional, polished, confident sounding playing. So being able to practice something so it's in your body and your mind so much that you don't have to think about it, so you can free up your attention to then make it sound good. And that comes back to when you're relaxed, you are able to then manipulate the techniques in real time to make things work. If you notice, if you're playing along to a live drummer, if they're pushing and pulling on the beat, if you're playing along with a singer and they've forgotten a vocal bit, and if you're not playing to a click, you might need to go around again. Or do you know the structure of it and you're confident enough to know exactly where you are? And half of, you know, musicianship is learning how to hide mistakes, and learning how to hide mistakes is more about confidence, relaxation, knowing the song. So hopefully this is making sense. I've got some good questions coming in, but I'll come to them in a moment. I can see Claude has asked a question, and some of the posture, fantastic. People saying they're using a looper, great, fantastic. So that's the levels of understanding. Michael Jordan didn't think about basketball. He was basketball. Yes, that's very zen. You know, when you do the dishes, do the dishes. Don't think about doing the dishes. And even when you're preparing, don't think about preparing. Just think about the preparing. You know, you're doing the activity. But all of this equates to very present-minded practice and relaxed practice. Now, so part of this is also in the preparation, is feedback in your preparation. So first of all, recording yourself, hearing yourself back. And I've had the luxury of seeing myself on various, I never watch anything I do at Licklibrary, but sometimes it will come on a screen or something and I'm like, oh wow, that performance went really badly or it went really well. Or, you know, I try not to think about it anymore. I think that's one thing. But in my own personal practice, it's useful to actually listen back. And you can sometimes see, oh, wait a minute, I'm tensing up. I can hear the tension in my playing, or I'm rushing that passage, or Maybe I don't know that part as well. So that recording yourself gives you instant feedback on your own terms. And then depending on where you're performing this, are you performing this for a gig or is this for a recording session? Playing standing up, playing it at volume, band volume. If you can't do that at home, I suggest practicing with headphones so you can actually hear the details, so you're not scared of how you sound. This is a big problem with especially more modern generations of guitar player. They're very used to playing through monitors in their rooms, and that's totally fine. But when it's loud, and when you stood up and you're sweating and you're tired, and you know there's loads of traffic on the way to the gig, and you've had a 5-minute sound check, you know, it's a different ball game. So are you confident enough to play at volume? This is why prep is also useful. Then the other one is playing with no references to charts, if you've written anything down. I would encourage people to make their own notes as they're learning songs. I think it adds another layer of memorization process, and also it gives you a handy sort of thing to look back on if you have to learn that song again in the future and you've forgotten it, and it'll be one of your own charts. That's useful, very useful. I'm happy to talk more about that in detail if you'd like. And then also playing about looking at the fretboard again, and that comes down to why the sensory aspect is so important. I've done it a few, you know, you can get wrapped up in the fretboard just because it's there. We seem to hunch over it. It affects our posture, affects our breathing, affects our playing. Our breathing then changes our body's kind of psychological energy as well, so then we end up feeling more anxious because we're not breathing properly, or we're just, you know, we're kind of holding our breath and tensing, and then tension spreads, and then that makes it, you know, then if you make a mistake, then you're more primed for rumination, which is going to make you make more mistakes. So, you know, mindfulness is pretty important, and breathing is really important, and bodily awareness is really important. So that's kind of the pillars, I would say, of how I go about approaching. Let me just recap that, then I'll come to some questions. I hope everyone's doing okay, by the way. So we've gone through listening to it properly, you know, making sure you're breaking it down, practicing it slowly, looping sections, working on those tricky parts, and then leaving them, coming back to them the next day, letting them settle in your nervous system, so you're actually giving yourself a chance to memorize good information rather than bad information. And then just a reminder, auditory, knowing how it sounds, visual, seeing it on the fretboard and understanding the theory, and then sensation, how it feels to play. It should feel as light, you get it as comfortable as possible. Have it so it feels good to play as much as you can. And that comes back to breathing, posture, lightening up. And then levels of understanding, being able to perform the track from a listening perspective rather than a thinking, what am I doing perspective. So you can affect the music in real time with the musicians or the backing track. And then recording yourself, feedback and preparation, you know, making sure you're practicing the song in a playing environment that you plan to perform the song in. That's very much a very big part of that. Okay. I'm just going to bring up a point, actually. I'm just going to go over to the... If you are practicing this stuff, it's useful to have backing tracks to practice along to. Hopefully, if you sometimes with a band, if you're doing covers and stuff, you'll have reference tracks, or they'll tell you to go on Spotify or something and play along to the tracks. You know, but Licklibrary have tons of backing tracks. We've got loads of. I mean, this is just what this is in order of latest tracks, I think, or alphabetical order, but it just keeps on going. These are all professional backing tracks made by various musicians here at Licklibrary and around, and there's loads of stuff, and it's very good to practice along to guitarless backing tracks and record yourself and see if you can get it close to the original. I'd say it's a really big important part of changing your playing as well, because we can practice lots of exercises and things, but we learn as humans through imitation. We don't exist in a vacuum, so it's good to kind of, you know, actually play with something objectively, and also without the guitar part. If you have a guitar backing track where you don't have the guitar part for the song, or you have some software where you can remove it, you're then able to hear exactly what you're actually doing, which can be very revealing, but actually help you hone in and be a bit more objective about your preparation for the song. So yeah, I'm just going to leave that. I'm going to look at some questions here. David says, this is all good advice, but how are we meant to teach it to the bassist? Here we are. We all have to deal with that thing. Oh, cool. Okay, Dan asks a good question here. I'm just going to show this on the screen. How should practice change when working on an aspirational level building to songs to challenge yourself? I'd say it's the same thing. It's exactly the same thing. In fact, even more so. You know, I don't have time to necessarily loop things or practice things super slowly when it comes to professional live playing. But when it comes to songs and things I'm looking to push myself. I always come at practice from a curiosity approach. I love the sound of the solo. I want to learn it. Let's do it. Or this will really help me take care of my playing, keep my chops up. I think that's a nice attitude to have. But I'd say it's the same approach, Dom, to just keep it, you know, light, keep it structured, you know, timing your sessions, not spending too long on each song as well, because sometimes the period of time between visiting the song can help with the memorization. I can't talk properly. It helps with the sort of implementing of that new knowledge if you have a gap and have rests, because your brain does a lot of stuff in the background. Okay, let's see if there's any other questions coming in which might be quite useful. Claude asks, I'm having a difficult time playing light. Any suggestions? Well, this is a good old tip I picked up off Grandmaster Rick Graham. I'm aware, actually. This camera might turn off in a moment, but I will turn it back on and I won't be anywhere. I take a note, press it down as hard as possible, and then take it off until it buzzes. And then imagine putting on 0.0001%. That's good. And then you'll realise, actually, that's all you really... It's probably a lot lighter than you would normally play. I'd also focus on keeping your fingers connected to the fretboard, actually using that as a sort of mantra. Rather than, you know, doing this, sort of keeping your hand flowing. I would say that, you know, you want your playing to... This is a weird one. Probably a kind of sounds more zen or something, but the camera's coming back on now. There we are. Is to focus on making your playing kind of look elegant. That sounds so kind of shallow, but like, does it feel and look elegant when you play? It will affect the tone of your playing. It'll affect everything, your poise and everything. Now, I'm not saying what I'm doing is necessarily elegant, but I do try to keep my hand light. And if you keep your hand light, you know, speed and chord changes become a bit easier. Check your breathing. That's a big one. Check your breathing. Are you taking short inhalations and short exhalations? You know, maybe take a deep breath and let an out breath go. Just relax yourself. You know, bring your shoulders, get more of a spacious awareness rather than the kind of awareness of, you know, a pair of eyes and a fretboard. And when that happens, you lose the auditory a little bit. So come back to listening. Can be helpful. That can be useful. I know it sounds very esoteric, but you have to try it out. Okay, any other questions as we go? Cool. Right. Backing tracks, Timothy says, yes, backing tracks keep your timing in check and help you continue the song even if you make a mistake. Yeah, it really helps you kind of hone in on like the structural elements of it and making sure that you're in the zone. Fantastic. David comes in. David says, I'd like to get a basic framework of the whole song and gradually work on adding details. Yeah, that's a really good point. I'm going to highlight that comment, David. It might be quite a long one, but hopefully you can see it. Yeah, I would say like building the song as you learn it. You know, this is what I've come back to. You know, you listen, you get a global view. You know, when you're on Google Earth and you zoom right out and you start zooming in and you start to see the countries and continents, and then you zoom in even more and you start to see the states or counties, and then you zoom in more and you can see where the nearest Tesco's is, you know, and it kind of gets more detailed as we go. And I think that's a healthy approach, because sometimes we can listen to it, especially a complicated song, and we can dive straight into the, oh God, that's technical. And I've done that, especially when I've got lots of songs to learn and I think, oh, there's that one song and it's got that solo in it. And I feel like I've not prepared for the gig because of that one thing. But actually, there's the rest of it to be aware of as well, the rest of the songs. So is that macro and micro? I don't know. Maybe people could tell me. Looking for those fancy words. Yeah. Cool. So, right. Has anybody got any more questions? let me know, write them in the comments, I'll be happy to answer them, especially regarding this topic of performance to professional professionalism. As you're writing the comments, I'm just going to come to licklibrary.com just quickly. If you're a member, we've got loads of new courses. I keep on saying it, but Stu Shields, he makes some amazing little course things. I did some 5 licks in the style of Holdsworth recently. Speed building fundamentals, that's another one of mine. I'm touting my courses. And there's loads. Rich Shaw, fantastic guitarist. I love Rich. Songwriting styles of metal. We've got What Makes the Blues of Mitch Laddie. That's fantastic. Fundamentals of Country Guitar of Eric Holbom. Like, it's just amazing. If some of the theoretical stuff is kind of making you a bit confused, then I've done a theory basics course for rhythm and for mapping notes on the fretboard. We've got loads more. I did Frank Gambale licks. I remember doing that one. That's great. Rock guitar first steps with the amazing Nick Jennison, and Danny Gill recently did Surfing of the Alien. That's such. I need to actually get that course because I love that album, and I love all the tutors at Lick Library. But I got a soft spot for Danny because he's just awesome and a lovely guy. Okay, some good questions coming in. I'm just going to keep. Okay, I'm going to go for one. Danny's asked a good question there about what's going on in your soloing, but I'm going to answer the sort of more song-related, learning-related ones first. What do you do regarding cheat sheets? Can we do what? Can we see one? Let's have a look. oh, dearie me. I mean, this is just so random. Like, this is for something I did for an original project that had a string section, so I had to transpose the strings into a tab. But sometimes I'll just do literally like slashes, like C, A minor, F, section A, section B, this, and then if there's like a riff, I'll just write a few tab lines and just do a little reminder. But I don't, and then I'll upload it to my iPad and stick it on an iPad. But generally, I try and forget it. As quick, I find that sometimes writing the charts can help, and it's useful. But also, just if we've got short notice, charts might not always help. Depends on the gig. If I'm allowed a chart, which is very rare, but I'll try to get rid of that as quickly as possible. But basically, whatever helps you is going to be useful. And generally, I would say the simpler the better, because you'll be able to quickly look at it and go, ah, there's the thing. So you're using the cheat sheet as a primer rather than the actual song. Hopefully that helps. Good one from Craig. How do you deal with frustration and dealing with harder parts so you don't give up and move on to another song or section? First of all, good wallop of compassion and self-kindness. Like, what you're learning is what was probably more natural for someone else. And you're programming your nervous system. And if you program it nervous, if you program it, I can't do this, then it's going to get even harder. So I would spend time breaking things down to smaller sections, going slowly, going lightly. Playing along with the track at a slower tempo builds a sense of satisfaction. I did that for the Big Trouble solo for Steve Vai, Eat 'Em and Smile. I just play along to the solo at 60, 70% speed, and it felt satisfying because I was actually playing it along to the track, and I actually found that satisfaction and enjoyment started to help the process a bit more. Also, take a break. Limit the amount of time you're spending on some of these harder sections. So it's like training a dog. Like as soon as you notice yourself getting frustrated, leave it. Come back to it. You're human. Not all of us. There's licks. There's thousands. And also depends on what it is. I mean, if it's a riff or something integral to the song, fine. But if it's part of like an improvised solo, like a Guthrie Govan thing or something crazy, where it's just like a complete, just it, obviously for Guthrie it was just something that came out. He wasn't thinking mechanically, he was just flowing with what was in his muscle memory and felt right at the time. So maybe it's more to, if it's something like that, maybe to come up with something similar that you can do in that moment. You don't have to copy things verbatim. Get creative with it. Use it as a catalyst to take you into your own creativity. But taking breaks and taking it in short chunks, and remembering your mindset is also what you're programming into what you're learning. So, and there's loads of things. Breathing, again, when you start to calm your breathing down, you start to feel a bit more less psychologically whole mindfulness thing of that someone wrote, you know, when Michael Jordan's playing basketball, he's not thinking about it, he's doing it. And the same thing is a lot of our suffering is caused by, you know, taking our thoughts as real when actually all that's happening is this. It's just, where is the center? Where's the future and the past? It's all here. And actually you feeding that is kind of creating more of that. So be kind to yourself, be aware, take your time. You're probably doing fantastic. And play along to the track if you can at slow tempos, because it will give you that satisfying feeling. Okay, hopefully this is making sense. And similarly, Don says, similar question to Craig, how do you know when to finally walk away from a song that ultimately ended up being too hard for me? I've done that with so many songs, you know, like Scarified, Paul Gilbert. I just can't, you know, it's one of those songs I look at and I go, oh, still can't get that quite to speed. That's okay, it doesn't matter. When you're learning a song, you have to be very clear about what the goal is. Like, why are you learning it? And also being able to appreciate that it's somebody else's tune, and it's a beautiful expression of the potentiality of music, and you have that potential too. You know, go and create something. You know, make your own versions of these songs. Write something. You know, you don't have to master every song. You know, you will have made so many gains in your playing beyond even what you can technically play. You'll have learned about the shapes on the neck, the rhythm, all the discipline you had in practicing that has probably exponentially improved your playing beyond mastering it perfectly, just like the original. Obviously, we strive for perfection because perfection is impossible and it's a useful kind of like goal, but perfection never happens. So even the people who write the songs find it hard to play them sometimes. So keep that in mind. Cool. Have you visualized techniques prior to actual performance? Anything actors? I don't know what the actor's toolkit is. I try not to think about it too much before performance. I think the less I think about it, the better it goes. If I've done the prep, then sometimes a bit of anxiety is actually not bad. And sometimes anxiety is just excitement, and it will keep you very present on the gig, so you will be fully there. Living it, enjoying it. Don't overthink it. Don't think. That's not possible because there's no thinker. The thinker is the thought, as Krishnamurti would say. I saw some more technical questions in there. Okay. Got a technical question from Danny. He says, what's happening in your brain when soloing? Do you see all the notes or patterns? I guess I do. I know what's going on a fretboard. Vaguely, hopefully. I like the analogy of setting the table. You know where your cutlery is. You don't just get your spaghetti and throw it on the table. You put a plate down, some knives and forks first. You kind of know where you're going a little bit. And then you should just let go and go for it. I'm at the moment working with just listening for where I'm allowing myself to develop tension and release. Because I often resolve things too early, I find, in my phrasing. So actually letting things have a question mark after them allows me to come up with more developmental ideas. So that's if I'm thinking about anything, it's kind of that. And that goes back to that listening. You know, you don't have to try to listen. This is a big thing. It feels like there's a person listening, but actually if you just stop for a moment, and even my voice ranting on right now, you're not choosing to hear that. That's just coming in. And I guess it's the same with playing. You let it appear. And it's the not knowing mind actually helps kind of, oh, there's that potential. Rather than when you go, it's going to be like this and I've got to use this pattern, suddenly things start to break down and become fragmented and it becomes a bit stiff. You know, it's like a good joke. I don't know where that analogy was going. Oh, gosh. Yeah, cool. It's easy to get philosophical. For me, a lot of performance also, you start to learn about things like body posture, you know, exercise, things like this starts to come into it. Healthy mindset, sleep, rest, designating your time properly. You know, I'm very much into Zen literature, and there's a philosopher called Krishnamurti who I quite like. He talks about, you know, kind of the actuality of experience and performance, and when, you know, thought, he says, is dead, but attention is alive, not knowing is alive. Not knowing, the Zen saying is, not knowing is most intimate. And that doesn't mean not knowing anything. It means the edge of listening and inquiring. And that can be useful for listening and opening up your head space when you're playing. Provided, of course, you've practiced, and that all comes into practice as well. I make it sound like I think about this a lot, and I probably do, but you know, I just try and play. Okay, we're coming up to the end of this, but I really hope this has been helpful. I'm just going to look through these comments. This will be available on replay, of course, as well on the old YouTube channel. But we will be back soon. So thank you so much for tuning in. I hope this has been helpful. I know it's a lot of talking, and I don't really like doing. I prefer to be sat here playing. You know, Michael Jordan plays basketball. He doesn't think about it. And the same, we should all be playing guitar and just doing the thing. You know, it's the most obvious stuff, really. That's what philosophy is about, isn't it? It's talking about the obvious stuff that we kind of gloss over in daily life and realizing, oh yeah, pay attention, be kind to yourself. That's it. Be kind to others. Be kind to yourself. And look after your body, because your body is kind of doing all this memorization and listening. You know, this is a process unfolding, and how you put into that process is what you'll get out. And most professionals will talk about this level of apprehension. They'll use their own language to explain it. And lots of artists like to say, yeah, just don't think about anything. And that's easier said than done. But it comes down to just paying attention and be kind. All right. Cool. Keith, thank you. Claude, thank you. Thanks for all your questions. We'll be back at some point soon, I'm sure. I'm always doing a lot of these every month, so it's lovely to see you all. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you all very soon. Take care. Thank you.